Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is D.C.-based producer, director, and actor Ron Newcomb. Please welcome Ron Newcomb.
Thanks for being here.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it. Thanks. Now,
in our many productions of Studio A over the years, we've had guests with a wide variety of backgrounds.
Yeah.
But you might have the widest variety of all in one person. You've been a police officer. You're a pastor.
Yep.
You're a filmmaker, and as I said in the open, a variety of roles within that. And more that we'll talk about later. How did you arrive at this destination?
Yeah, I think it's a little bit of a unique story, and I think that's kind of the big takeaway, is to allow each person's story to be unfolded uniquely and not really allow it to be kind of defined or predetermined to try to follow some formula. So to me, it was a desire really of service, trying to be a servant to the community, from being a cop to being, working at a church as a pastor, and then certainly as a filmmaker. And it was really over a bigger ideal of, trying to be a hero in a bigger story. And so, in those three roles, independently, you can be the hero. And I think my generation was really concerned with trying to make a difference, not really concerned about how much money somebody made. They really wanted to be somebody, to be significant. And I think those vocations have allowed me to fulfill that need within myself.
It's very interesting. You line them up in a way that I haven't heard before.
Yeah.
Frankly, because I never thought of those three things in the same breath before. It's really quite
right.
Interesting. Now, you also have a George Mason connection. You were an administration of justice major.
That's correct.
Tell us about that. And I think you were doing that while you were in the police force.
Yeah, that was a very, very unique opportunity that George Mason really reached out to the community, one of which was in law enforcement. And so they came out to our department and taught classes. Mm-hmm. And so I was able to come in off the street. I'd go to work for a couple hours, come in off the street, had to take off the cop hat and put on the student hat, do 4 hours of classes, and then go back out on the street. And I did that for a couple years while I was working midnights. And that allowed me, though, to finish my education. I went to Nova, the community college locally, got 2 2-year degrees, and then ultimately went on to get my 4-year degree here at Mason.
How have these educational and life experiences influenced your work as a filmmaker?
I think the big thing is that, again, it's part of a bigger picture, and it's the sense of, I feel that there's a very finite way of, good and evil. And, again, where is my role in the context of that big picture? And as a law enforcement officer, it's very defined in that. And so to me, those are the films that I like. I like a very strong protagonist, one with a good character arc. I like a really good bad guy. Hellboy 2 had a really, really good bad guy. And that's one that, I can relate to. And I can see myself, if I were to, slip up or go a different direction, then I could have found myself there. So to me, as a law enforcement officer, it really kind of set the stage for that. And, those are the stories I like. They're the ones I resonate the most with, so.
And there are clear narratives in that line of work. And I guess also in a funny way in religion, where it's all about telling great stories, or
you
at least
it.
Partly about that.
Absolutely.
And so you're bringing these things together in your films.
Right.
How did you find your way to your current position as the owner of a company and filmmaker?
It really was a unique experience. I think you can get caught up once you graduate college. You get into a vacation of what you deem as a career, and then before you know it, you've got 5 or 6 years in wondering, is this it for me? Is this what I was created for? Is this the sense of my destiny? And so I think it gets to a point where you need to decide on where that kind of plays out. And so I kind of felt like I was at the inroads to make a decision to either continue down the path of law enforcement as a career or to, begin a new vocation in the area of filmmaking. So I decided that was the opportunity. I tried to seize it and go for it, and that's what I did.
So 6 years or so in the police force,
yeah.
And then did you just go cold turkey?
I'm a big academic guy, so originally I knew that I needed to have a potential fallback plan.
Sure.
And so if law enforcement wasn't it, then I began to work on a master's degree in counseling.
Mm-hmm.
So ultimately graduated with a master's in counseling, all the while taking classes, seminars, workshops locally and even somewhat out of the area to begin my education in filmmaking. And I started with writing. Mm-hmm. I went to a 2-month, 8-hour day boot camp on screenwriting. How to create character, story. Those things are paramount. I'm sure as everybody knows, as filmmakers, the story is the key element. The screenplay is extremely crucial to what you're trying to do.
What was your first paycheck in the film world?
It came as an actor. My first love was acting. So I had an opportunity to do some acting gigs. Being in the DC area, we get a lot of big films that come from LA. So they hire all their crew there, their main actors. But then those of us here, we either get PA work or extra work. So I did some extra work. And I think I'm in a movie, just in the background where you can see the back of my head go by. I know it's me. But
Right. Very good. Now you have a production company, Opening Act Productions. Tell us a little bit about that and its work.
Yeah, Opening Act Productions really was an opportunity where I was at a church for 4 years and started a group, a filmmakers group, and we got it to about 450 people, active members.
That's enormous.
It was big within the church community. And so from there, what happened was that, and I think what students will notice is that some people kind of rise to the top, the cream kind of rises to the top. And so I looked to my left and to my right, and those people I began to kind of really rally around and next to, and they were about the same level as I was. And so we began to get together and meet more regularly, and through that we formulated this company. And then we weren't too strong on business, so then I went back to another coworker of mine from the past that I worked with on the police department, who's a great businessman who's now in business for himself. We pulled him in, and so there's kind of three of us, a fantastic writer, myself, and then a great business guy.
What are some of the challenges of a startup production company, and what kind of work do you do that pays the bills?
Yeah, that is, I think, the challenge. I think a lot of filmmakers want to know the question of how do you finance movies? Mm-hmm. And that isn't a question, that is the question. Mm-hmm. And you need to see yourself as a filmmaker primarily as a producer. A producer really is one who can bring forth the funds. And so that is, that's kind of the question for us is, and the challenge, frankly, is how do you bring the finances? Who does it? Where do you get it? And there's no set formula. One, you need to have a strong business sense. And so those are the challenges, is to get out of the creative, which is, I think, a lot where we stay, and the technical. We either dissect ourselves very technically or very creatively. But don't forget, it's show business, not show art.
Right.
So you need to be prepared to go to somebody and say, here's your ROI, and be able to explain those things.
So. Terrific. Let's see if our student audience has any questions for you. Who's first? Yes.
Hi, my name is Will, and I was wondering, do you primarily see yourself as a director, producer, or actor?
That's a good question, and I think the answer would be you need to be one or the other at individual times. You cannot be all three. You can't, pull a Mel Gibson like in Braveheart and bust out and be the actor and the director all at once. You either need to be, the producer, and that's the primary hat that I wear, or the director, and so it's very definitive by everybody. Or when I'm an actor, I'm in front of the camera and I'm not directing at all. I completely take the hat over. You need to have confidence in your team, and we had a great DP, and I turned it over to him and he called the shots. So.
Yeah. And a DP for the listening audience.
Yes, is your director of photography. So he's really gets a sense early on. He's brought early on to really encompass the look and the feel of the film, and he knows the story intimately. So
great. Another question.
Be a good one
from the audience. Yes.
Hi, I'm Christy. Washington D.C. is known for documentary films. Yeah. How do you find support for a narrative in this area?
Finding support for a narrative is hard. One of the things I think we have in the DC market is a lot of technical people, and we have a lot of people that have a desire to want to get into narrative filmmaking, but few people that can do that. So once you start to pull in the resources, I think people rally to your cause. I mean, everybody jumps over the woodwork to really try to work with you. But I think that's the big point, is having the resources. And again, that unfortunately goes back to money. We've created a little sense in DC where you don't get paid for anything.
And it's kind of a weird thing. You get, you see everything. It says, you know, food, copy, credit, food, copy, credit. Food is pizza. You never get your copy of the work you work on, and your credit will be on the film only if you can see it. So we, as filmmakers in the D.C. area, need to change that, and we need to demand that, you know, change comes from within. And so the only way we're going to do that is to pay people. And so that's what we do. We paid everybody on our set. Now, we did have some deferments, but my goal is to pay everybody. You know, they do that in L.A. Why are we doing it any different in D.C.? And I think once you do that, you'll start to see people really rally to our cause.
It's a radical idea. Yeah. Another question.
Hi, I'm Corey. If you could make any film with money and resources as no object, what would it be?
Well, I'm a big epic adventure guy, you know, and I think that's important to be honest with yourself of where you kind of lie, what genre really hits you. And so I would do a huge epic battle royale of Braveheart meets 300 with the King David story. I'm working on a screenplay right now that I think we can do that. Now, that's no low budget feature, but so what? You know, somebody's got to do it. Why not be me? So, yeah, that's it's a big action epic adventure.
Ever thought of claymation for something like that?
I have, but that probably costs just about
right,
the same.
Yeah, in time, if nothing else.
Exactly.
Right? Very good.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of big epic pictures, your company, you have just made one.
Yes.
In a kind of a backhanded, interesting way, called The Fellow's Hip.
Right.
And we have a couple clips from that piece.
Great.
And I'd like to show the first one, which is a kind of a almost a trailer. It's a series of production moments, montage. Let's look at that, and then we'll talk about it.
That'd be
The
great.
Fellow's Hip. So what we've just seen is a collection of scenes from this new movie, The Fellow's Hip. There's a couple things I want to ask about. One is the casting process for this film. You've got quite a range of ages and types. How did you go about putting that ensemble together?
Well, you know, we used a very smaller casting agency, but we did pull in a casting director that was allowed us to really cast a very broad net. And then it's using the local D.C. area channels to get the word out. And in the local community, there's some really good avenues, some Yahoo groups that you can join to really help, you know, in spreading the word out. But we went as high as we had some actors come down from Pennsylvania, and we had some drive up from North Carolina. So I didn't allow that to limit me. I figured, hey, I was an actor, and sometimes I was willing to drive 4 or 5 hours for a role. And if the actor was willing to do it, then I was willing, you know, to let them audition and even cast them with no, you know, merit on whether or not they could drive the distance or would drive the distance. So we auditioned 250 people for the main primary four roles. And then out of those, we were able to fill the other roles. So I had them read for the four primary roles, but then I would say, oh, you know what? He looks more like a Joe or someone else. Mm-hmm. And so we were able to cast that way. But anybody that wanted to audition, we allowed them to.
And the basis of the film is kind of a, not a parody, but kind of a takeoff on The Lord of the Rings.
Yes, it is. It's really about a journey, friendship. You know, these four really geeky online gamers get a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to go on a journey, on a quest for a competition to be declared, you know, the fellowship. And so they ultimately get sabotaged, and in order to right the wrong, they set off on a journey that parallels The Lord of the Rings. And in the end, they learn that there's a little bit of geek and hero in all of us, which I think is very true.
Did you have to, and that's in the subtitle, more or less, or the tagline for
yeah,
the film.
Exactly.
Did you have to work with the Tolkien folks or the filmmakers to get permission to use the story?
Absolutely. When you first are writing the screenplay, you don't allow those encumbrances really to dictate to you. We had some parameters that we had to be able to film it. It had to be able to be filmed locally and around here for us, by us. So the things that we loved was that. And so that kind of spelled out on the pages. And so we began to write this screenplay. And so when you're in the writing process, it didn't really matter. But once we got to, pre-production, mm-hmm, and the screenplay set and we're going into production, certainly you needed to cross all the T's and dot the I's. So we had Twinkies in the movie, and we had to get permission by Twinkies mm-hmm, to use them to throw a Twinkie at a guy. And they had some changes in the script that they wanted changed. So
Twinkie asked for changes.
Absolutely, they did. So we changed it.
And I've never said anything right like that in my life.
And then we had to get permission, the Saul Zaentz Group, which is they own the intellectual property rights for the Tolkien estate. They had to read our script and sign off on it. And then we have a pretty unique relationship with the Lord of the Rings online game. And so I had to reach out to them, of course, and develop a relationship with them, which we're still working of how really that's all going to play out. But it's been very exciting, a lot of fun. And, you know, that taps into, the kind of hero theme in all of us. I mean, those guys really did it well,
yeah,
Tolkien.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm a big fan of both the books and the
yeah,
films, actually.
Yeah.
Now, we have another clip from the film, which is a more extended scene.
Yes.
Can you set that up for us?
Yeah, this showcases a little bit more of the acting, and there's some reasons why we chose this particular sequence. But really what happens is the kids along the way, their car breaks down, and so they find themselves in the middle of a hippie commune, as you would, you know, on a journey like that. And so,
of course.
And the ring is translated to a flash drive. So the young guy, our hero, wears a flash drive around his neck, and one of the leaders of the hippie commune sees the flash drive and knows that that's a real big deal to him, so she ends up taking it. So in order to decide who's going to be the rightful owners of the flash drive, they decide to have a paintball battle, which of course you would have
right,
in a hippie commune.
Yep.
So then that kind of plays out. So this is setting up where there's a showdown between our heroes and the four new antagonists that are brought on, challenging the rightful owner of the flash drive.
Terrific. Let's watch.
Hey, what's the rush?
It's gone.
What's gone?
The drive.
Good morning and hello. We greet you this fine morning.
It's not so good.
You seem troubled.
I lost something.
Perhaps, or perhaps it left you. Perhaps it decided you didn't deserve it. Perhaps it thought that you are just a bunch of clueless dorks who should know their place.
Cool, they even say dork here. How cool is that?
Do you have my drive?
You mean this shiny little thing?
Give me that back!
People, dear people, it is a beautiful morning. A time for the shining sun and shining faces. What's going on here?
She stole my flash drive.
I don't know this flash drive he babbles about. I did find this shiny little thing. It found me.
These are troubling words.
Well, maybe it came to me. Do you not teach, Baba Melvin, that all matter belongs to everyone and that everyone belongs to all matter?
Do I? Yes. That could be true. That sounds very interesting and groovy. There is a purpose in all of this. Let us hum.
No!
Real.
No, I'm not going to hum. She's a thief.
We do not make such accusations lightly, my son. Your words are heavy, very heavy.
Heavy indeed. I demand that they take the test. If they win, they keep the drive. If they lose, it's mine. This is our way, and this is how a dispute shall be settled. Am I not right, Baba?
Maybe you are right. And maybe you are right. Come. Come. The test will prove who is the drive's rightful owner.
That's a really beautiful bunch of work there. I mean, photographically beautiful, and the acting is strong. That's a clip that is, I think you said earlier, is going to be used for some marketing purposes.
Yeah, what it is that, you know, as a filmmaker, you need to really start with the end in mind. Where are you going with this? Are you creating a very expensive DVD to show your family and friends and try to impress them? Or are you trying to make a sellable product? And so there's two basic ways to sell that. You can either go to the festival route in hopes that someone will find it and you know, you get some accolades, or you can go to a film market, which you hear about the American film market, Berlin, Cannes, those types of things. So we decided to go to the American film market this past year. So now they don't want to see just a trailer, because you can just add some music, make it look nice, and that's kind of it. They want to showcase some of the acting, they want to see the audio, they want to know that all the technical things are in order as well. So we had to put together that particular sequence in order to show potential buyers you know, the work that we've done
the
without
level
showing
of the quality
the
of
whole movie. Mm-hmm. They're not going to sit there and watch the hour and a half entire film, which is actually good for us because we're still in post-production.
Right. But that piece has been through post-production?
Exactly. We did everything through that. We shot on using two red cameras. We had a really good sound guy. And so we put together the whole package, completed as if it was done, and showcased that people saw it.
So it's a digital master, so to speak.
Exactly.
Shot digitally, and then it's been through all the.
You got it.
I predict good things.
Thank you.
Now I'd like to turn back to our students and see if there are any other questions from the audience.
Hi, I'm Paul. What advice would you have for a filmmaker trying to break into the industry?
Yeah, you know, I think everybody kind of at some point that does something like this, because I've been certainly in your seat most of the time, trying to figure out what's the nugget, what's the golden nugget that I can take away, help me get, you know, somewhere. And I think the biggest thing is that every story is unique, is that don't try to be so formulaic that you're trying to find a path that, you know, a certain standard, where instead, you know, be different, be unique. That's the one thing that we have going for us. I think you need to decide, where do you want to work? Do you want to work independently, or do you want to work the studios? Two totally different things. And the other thing, know what hat you're wearing. Are you a director? Are you a writer? Are you a producer? To say you're an editor in the independent world means you're going to do everything in post. Well, anybody that knows in film, post is there's like 12 different jobs in post-production. So know what role you're going to play is key.
Great. Any other questions? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Calvin. I was wondering what filmmakers inspire you.
You know, I wish I could say some unique, you know, retro, like Italian, cool, new age director. But I like, you know, I like the epic guys. I like Lucas and Spielberg and Zack Snyder and Scorsese. And I think that reveals something about me, though, as a filmmaker. And that's when I began to realize that's the genre, the niche that I, too, want to play in, which I think is important, because I shouldn't be dabbling in the romantic comedy. You know what I mean? Because that's just not naturally me. Stay where you're naturally in. So I like the big guys. You know, I grew up with those guys. They're fun to watch. And, you know, they're now trying to look back and give back to. So if you watch some of the behind the scenes of those guys, it's like film school 101, you know, and it's great. So,
speaking of giving back, do you mind telling the little George Lucas story that we talked about in the green room?
No, absolutely not.
I think it's pretty cool.
Yeah. So we're talking currently with the distributor now in hopes that, you know, we might get picked up for representation and distribution internationally, domestically, and even theatrically. But one of the things that we had heard was that George Lucas had said, hey, you know, if you know any filmmakers, independent filmmakers, that need post-production work, let us know, and they could actually come to Skywalker Ranch and do all the post in-house there, and he'd help them out. Now, I'm not suggesting anybody be emailing George saying, I'm your guy. But, you know, certainly I kind of akin it to climbing a rock wall. And, you know, we all need to get to a point of stability. But once we're stable enough that we can look back and see who's below and next to us, we have a responsibility to pull up everybody else and to push them even beyond us. And I think that's what he's done very well, and I admire him for that. So
you're going to go? Yeah.
If the invitation is there, I would go. That's an absolute fact.
That's terrific. What is the most rewarding part of your job?
You know, to me, it's we've got a room full of aspiring filmmakers. It's to collaborate with others. I talk to a lot of filmmakers in this day and age where they're one, two, three people tops, and they don't want anybody else into their little group and their little circle. And to try to break into that is like an anomaly. It's so frustrating as a filmmaker. And so I love to get opportunities. I love team. I grew up playing sports, so I know what, you know, team is about. And I appreciate that element of it. So that's very rewarding. We had 28 crew members. We had 31 actors, 150 extras. And it was just really cool to be able to give people an opportunity.
And you started with 450.
Yeah,
how many are still making films?
Actively, there's probably about 100, 125 active members within that filmmaking group.
That's amazing. Yeah. Real quickly, what's next for you?
Well, certainly, I would love to say another film is around the corner, but what I need to do is I have the post-production supervisor's hat on right now, mm-hmm. so I'm trying to drive the finish of that product in order to be able to represent ourselves right. well, to prove concept that we can turn out a product and that we can sell it. And that we're a good bet for an investment. And then we certainly have two other screenplays ready to roll if we find investors.
Fantastic.
We're ready.
I'm looking forward to seeing
it. Yeah, thank you.
Ron Newcomb, it's been a pleasure. Thanks for being on Studio A.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I appreciate you having me.
I'm Rick Davis. This is Studio A. Thanks for watching.